Let's get along with the session for the day. So in the last session, we had seen about the work done. And from our discussion, we saw that, you know, if I move in the direction of the field, then I do not have to do any work because the field will exert a force on a charge. Okay, but if I have to move a charge against the field from one point to another point, then I have to expend some work. Why? Because I am moving against, I have to counteract the force which the field, electric field, is exerting on the charge, right? So we derived the equation that the work done is equal to minus Q integral of E dot dl, right? And then we saw that if E is constant along the path where we are moving, I can take E outside the integral, and the whole integral simply becomes integral of dl, which is the length traveled. And let's proceed from there. Okay, so now let me take a line charge. Okay, so we already know what is the field due to a line charge. What is the electric field due to a line charge? Rho L. Rho L is the charge density in coulombs per meter. I told you, you can also designate it as lambda. So it is rho L divided by 2 pi epsilon naught rho. This rho is the radial distance in the aero direction, that is in the radial direction. So if I have a line charge, everywhere my field is radial. Clear? So now let me fix the radius, okay? And I move in a circle around it. Are you getting my point? I keep the radius, fix the radius, and move along a circle. So now what will happen? We will see. So I have a line charge and I'm trying to move some charge Q around it. So what is the electric field? The field is, you know, lambda by 2 pi epsilon naught rho 1 a rho dot. I am moving along the circle, right? So what changes when I move along the circle? The radius is fixed, that angle changes. You know, in cylindrical coordinates, I have one parameter is phi. Phi changes. Z doesn't change. Z will change only if you move vertically up or down. So what changes when you move in a circle? Phi changes. So I move along that, some one initial point to another point. So here I have, this is my E. It is in aero direction, and this is my dl. Dl, since I am moving along a circular path, is rho 1. Rho 1 is the radius, fixed radius, d phi into aero, right? So from the initial point to final point, let us say I move along an arc from initial point to final point. Now what happens? You just see here, what is aero dot a phi? We know it is zero because aero and a phi are orthogonal. Therefore, this work done will be zero. Clear? So what can you conclude from this? To move in a circular path around an infinite line charge, that's important, we do not have to expend any work. Okay, this is important. Now let's see what happens if I move the charge radially. That means first I moved like this. When I move along the circle, we found that I don't need to expend any work. Now I move radially from a radius B to a radius A, right? So now what will be my dl? Dl is d rho a rho, because I am moving radially. Dl is d rho a rho. This is my E, and I am moving from an initial radius B to a final radius A, right? So I get rho L is a constant. I take it up. And what is this Q, please? This Q is the charge you are moving. It's not the charge configuration which is producing the field. This rho L is the charge which is producing the field. And you are moving a charge Q in the field produced by this line charge from a radius B to a radius A. So all these are constants. I take out, then I get integral of 1 by rho, which is nothing but log from B to A. It is log of A to B. That is natural logarithm. Okay, so now since A is greater than B, because I'm assuming I'm moving radially outward, A is greater than B. Therefore, this log A by B will be positive, right? So and W, I have a minus sign here, is neg, so the net W will be negative. What does that mean? So in a line charge, if I move radially from a smaller radius to the larger radius, so I am moving like this, okay? So what is the field due to the line charge? That is also in this direction. So essentially, how are you moving your charge? You are moving the charge in the direction of the field. So that's why your work done is coming negative, which means that your external source need not expend any energy. In fact, it will receive energy from the electric field. Okay, the same thing, supposing A is lesser than B, that means what? I am moving from B to A. Okay, so B initial point is at a greater radial distance and the final point is at a lesser radial distance. So I am moving from B to A. So now what is happening? The field is in this direction, radially outward, but I am moving radially inward. So I am working against the field. And so that time what happens, if A is less than B, this log A by B will be negative. I already have a negative here, so the work done will be positive. So you saw the same thing with point charge also. When you move in the direction of the field, you don't need to expend any energy. And when you move against the field, you need to expend energy, which is equal to minus integral of E dot dl. So it agrees in both the cases. Okay, so now let's do a small problem before we proceed to other things. So I have a field, this is in Cartesian coordinates, e to the power of 10 e to the power minus 10 e to the power of y sine 2z ax plus x sine 2z ay plus 2x cos 2z as volts per meter. This expression per se is not important. How you solve the problem is important. Now you find E at P 5, 0, pi by 12. Okay, so this is my point, x, y, z. So substituting this point into the field, what do I have to do? I just have to substitute x is equal to 5, y is equal to 0, and z is equal to pi by 12. So here e to the power of 5 will become e to the power of y will become e to the power of 0. So I have minus 10. I substitute for z sine pi by 6 ax. So I get this. Okay. So if I evaluate sine pi by 6 and cos, I get this expression. So this expression minus 5 ax plus 225 ay plus 50 root 3 az. Right. So this is my electric field at point P. How did I get this? Simple. I simply substituted the coordinates of P into E. Right. Now, how much work is done in moving a charge of 2 nanocoulombs, a distance of 1 mm, only 1 mm I'm moving, from P, I'm moving in the direction of AX. Clear? So remember, what is the work done? Minus Q integral E dot dl, right? So now this is E, dl, what is dl? Dl is dx ax plus dy ay plus dz az, but I'm moving only in the x direction, 1 mm, so it is only dx ax. So if I take the dot product of E with dl, which is dx ax, so we know ax, ay dot ax is 0 and az dot ax is 0, so I will only be left with minus 5. Minus 5 ax dot ax, right? So what is q, what is the work done? Minus q, this q is the one you are moving, that is 2 nanocoulombs, right? E is minus 5, okay? And distance I am moving, dl, length is 10 to the power of minus 3, 1 mm. 1 mm is 10 to the power of minus 3 meters. So I get 10 pico joules. Okay? Fine. Now, you can ask me one question. E is a function of x, y, z. How are you taking a constant value of E? But remember, I am just moving a small incremental distance. Only 1 mm I am moving. Right? So in that 1 mm, I can assume E to be a constant. Okay? Fine. Next, instead of moving in AX direction, I move in AY direction. Then what happens? AX dot AY is 0 and AZ dot AY is 0. So only I'll have 25 AY. So E is effectively minus 25 AY. So I have minus Q E is minus 25, and again I'm moving 1 mm, so I get 50 picojoules. Similarly, if I move in AZ direction, so my E will be 50 root 3, and I move 1 mm, I get 100 root 3 picojoules. Okay, so now supposing I move 1 mm along AX, 1 mm along AY, and 1 mm along AZ, what happens? I move AX plus AY plus AZ, I move 1 mm in this direction. So I have E is E dot DL, I'll have in the direction, in this direction I want. So I need to get the unit vector in this direction. That would be the vector divided by its magnitude. What is the magnitude? AX plus AY plus AZ. Root of 1 plus 1 plus 1, that is root 3. Then from the previous case, I already have, if I move in x direction, so 1 mm along x is 10, 1 mm along y is 50, 1 mm along z is 100 root 3, right? So finally, into the unit vector, I get, which is 1 by root 3, I get 135 picojoules. Got it? So this is how you apply the formula. We'll try to do the problem if there is time, otherwise we'll move on to something very important and related to this work done. Now, as electrical engineering students, you are all very familiar with potential, voltage, etc. We have used these terms. Now let's try to define this from an energy perspective and from a field theory point of view and from a point of view of charges, what it means. Now, just like we defined electric field intensity, let's define potential difference V as the work done in moving a unit positive charge from an initial point to a final point, obviously in the presence of a field. Okay, if there is no field, then you have nothing to oppose, so potential will not be there only. So whether stated or not, it is implied that you are moving in a field. Okay, if you don't have a field, it becomes a very trivial case. So what is the work done? We saw it is minus Q integral from initial to final E dot DL. So how did I define potential? Potential in is difference is nothing but W. Please remember, I am not defining potential. I am defining potential difference. Clear? So potential is very arbitrary. Potential difference is clearly defined. So it is the energy required, work done, to move a unit positive charge. So Q becomes 1 coulomb from initial point to final point. Therefore, the potential difference V is written as minus integral initial to final E dot DL. Right? So there is a notation in field theory how we write it. We write VAB is the work done in moving a unit charge from B to A. Clear? A unit charge from B to A. So A is the final point and B is the initial point. Please remember that there is a reason for it, which we will visit later. It's a notation. So when I say VAB, it is the work done in moving from B to A. And here you can, when you talk of potential difference, you can talk of the initial point as a reference point. Okay? So what is the reference point? The reference point is the initial point. So does the potential difference depend on the reference? Yes. Because if I change the initial point, obviously we will change. So that is very important. And we'll see why we are discussing so much in the next upcoming slides. Okay, got it? Fine. So now let us see two or three important configurations which we normally are familiar with. So of course we know what is a point charge. So now let's assume a point charge and I want to move radially. You know, I have two points, right, RA and RB, and let's assume the point charge is located at origin. So these two points are at a distance of RA and RB respectively. So let's find out what is the potential difference. Okay, so what is E? I'll use spherical coordinates now. Now don't say ma'am is using sometimes cylindrical, sometimes spherical, and sometimes Cartesian. Of course, the whole concept of having three coordinate systems is use whatever is convenient for the problem at hand. Okay, fine. So now I have in spherical coordinates, E is equal to ER AR, right? And what is ER? The field in the radial direction. That is Q by 4 pi epsilon naught R squared AR in the radial direction. Field, you know, in the point charges due to radial, in the radial direction. Now I am moving in the radial direction only. So DL is DR AR. And what is VAB? Minus integral. I am moving, remember VAB, my notation is from B to A. E is Q by 4 pi epsilon naught AR dot DL is DR. So this integral becomes Q by AR dot AR is 1. So Q by 4 pi epsilon naught R squared DR. So Q by 4 pi epsilon naught is a constant. So minus integral of 1 by R squared, I get 1 by RA minus 1 by RB. Got it? Very important. So the potential difference between two points, the potential difference between two points when we move in a radial direction under a field produced by a point charge is given by Q by 4 pi epsilon naught 1 by RA minus 1 by RB, where RA and RB are the radial distances of the initial point and the final point. Okay, fine. Now, we'll see some cases. If RB is greater than RA, so what happens? My point, this is my field, my point charge is located here. So it produces a field in the radial direction. Now I move from B to A, and radius of point B is greater than radius of point A. So how am I moving? I am moving like this. Okay. So what will happen? Will this, so RB, look at this expression. RB is greater than RA. Since this is greater, this will be smaller, right? This will be smaller and this will be larger because RA is lesser. So this VAB will be positive. What does that mean? I have to expend energy. When do I have to expend energy? We saw from our previous discussions of energy that the external source has to expend energy every time we move against the field. That's precisely what I am doing now. You see, if B is at a further point, then I have to move from B to A. So I am, red line is the field. So I am actually moving against the field. And therefore, the potential difference is positive. Clear? Now, if RB is lesser than RA, you see here, this is B, this is A. So how am I moving? I am moving in the direction of the field. And obviously, if you look at this, since this is smaller, this will be larger. So VAB will be negative, which means that the external source need not do any work. The E itself will do work on the charge you are placing. Right? So the potential difference is positive if you are moving from far away to a point closer to the origin, and the potential difference is negative if you are moving from origin to here. Now, okay, let's get along. We'll see the potential difference due to a line charge. Now, when it came to line charge, we saw that I don't expend any energy if I move along a circle around the line charge, right? Therefore, if I move at between two points which lie at the same radius in a circle, okay, then potential difference across them will be zero because I don't need to have any energy, right? When did we see that you need energy? If you are moving radially. So if I am moving radially outward, then again I don't need to have any energy. Only when I move radially inwards, that is against the field, I get a positive energy. right? We saw what that energy was, Q into rho L by 2 pi epsilon naught log of B by A. Yes, B is the initial point and A is the final point, and therefore VAB, this Q will become, is the charge moving, and for potential difference it is unit, so it is rho L by 2 pi epsilon naught log B by A, right? So now you see, if this is positive only when B is greater than A, so that means from radially outward you are coming to a closer point, only then the work done is positive, same as before. Okay, so we saw potential difference. Now sometimes, yes, it is useful to define the potential of a particular point. Okay, so what we do is, this is my potential difference, right? Supposing I assume RB to be infinite. Infinite means what? Very far away, somewhere very far away. So then what happens? 1 by RB becomes 0 because RB is infinity. Therefore VAB will become Q by 4 pi epsilon naught RA. So what exactly, this is just a definition. Nobody says you have to take it at infinity. You take it anywhere. I have taken it at infinity for convenience because I want 1 by RB to be 0. Right? So I can define, one way of doing it is, you can treat the surface of the earth is treated as an infinite plane with zero potential, or the ground. But very difficult to define everything with respect to this reference. So the other choice is, I take it at infinity, then I can define the potential difference of a particular point as the work done in moving a unit positive charge from infinity to the point under consideration. I repeat, the absolute potential of a point is the work done in moving a unit positive charge from infinity to the point under consideration. So VAB is given, so now B is infinity, so it is Q by 4 pi epsilon naught RA. I can simply write it as VA because B is now known, B is at infinity. If I don't specify B, then I have to write this. Since B I understand is at infinity, I can very loosely say that the potential V at a point is Q by 4 pi epsilon naught R. And what is R? R is the radial distance of the point from the point charge, okay, which is creating the field. In general, same thing, the potential of any point at a radial distance R can be written as V is equal to Q by 4 pi epsilon naught R. Let's again make our premise clear. This Q is the charge, the point charge, which is creating the field, okay? And this V is the potential of a particular point, which is nothing but the energy you have to expend on a unit positive charge. And R is the radial distance between Q and the point where you want to find the potential. Okay, so I can write VAB, if you look at the previous expression, if you look at this, this is VA, and Q by 4 pi epsilon naught RB is VB, so I can write VAB as VA minus VB, provided I take both A and B with the same reference point. And what is my reference point here? It is infinity. So VA is the potential of point A with reference to infinity, and VB is potential of point B with reference to infinity. So I get VAB is equal to VA minus VB. Clear? Yeah. Now if I change my reference, what will happen? I can say C1 is the potential of my reference point, okay? And then I can say the reference of any point V at a point P, V is given by Q pi 4 pi epsilon naught R plus C1, where C1 is the potential of the reference point. Okay, so note one thing, the potential difference is unaffected by the choice of the reference point. Because if you take VAB, look at this equation. VAB is VA minus VB. And what is VA? Q by 4 pi epsilon naught R plus C1. And VB will be Q by 4 pi epsilon naught RB plus C1. So that C1 and minus C1 will get cancelled. So it doesn't matter. It's simple, like how you have in a graph, you have the origin. If a point is 5 meters from the origin, and now supposing I shift the origin reference to 1, then instead of, you know, 5, it would become 4, right? And what was originally 7 would now become 6. So the difference between 4 and 6 is the same as the difference between 5 and 7. So differences do not change when you change the reference. Absolute values will change. Okay, therefore this is very important. The potential difference is unaffected by the choice of the reference point. And is potential a vector or a scalar? It is a scalar quantity. And since it is energy per unit charge, the unit is joules per coulomb, or 1 joule per 1 coulomb is called as a volt, 1 volt. Okay, so it is joules per coulomb or volt. So now you see V is equal to minus integral of E dot dl. And now it is clear to you why E was given the unit of volt per meter. Because dl will come on the denominator, it becomes volt per meter, which is same as newtons per coulomb. And V is joules per coulomb or volts, which is given the name volts. Okay, clear? Fine. Now, an equipotential surface is one on which all the points have the same potential. So what is an equipotential surface? I have a charge configuration. Now there is a field due to this configuration. Now I try to connect all the points where the potential is a constant. So such a point, such a surface is called as an equipotential surface. Now what's the importance of an equipotential surface? I don't need to do any work if I have to move charge along the equipotential surface, because both of them are at the same potential. So VA will be equal to VB. So it will be VA minus VB will be equal to zero. So no work is done in moving a charge on an equipotential surface since there is no potential difference. Now if I have a point charge, right, what is an equipotential surface? The potential we saw was Q by 4 pi epsilon naught R. So all points which are at the same value of R from the point charge form an equipotential surface. So what is such a surface? It is a sphere. So if I have a point charge, a sphere at a radial distance of R is the equipotential surface. So I'll get concentric spheres which are equipotential surfaces. And if it's a line charge, you're right, there'll be concentric cylinders will be equipotential surfaces. Next, potential obeys superposition. That is, the potential at a point due to a number of charges is the sum of the potentials due to the individual charges. So force, Coulomb's force obeys superposition. Electric field intensity obeys superposition, and potential also obeys superposition. Okay, so the important features of electric potential are: the potential difference does not depend on the reference. You don't need to expend any work to move along equipotential surfaces, right? Absolute potential changes if you change the reference, and potential will obey superposition. These are the key features of electric potential. Again, you see here. So I have VAB is equal to VA minus VB. If I move, this is the energy to move from B to A. Okay, so this will be positive if VA is greater than VB. And this will happen if the radius of VB is, of point B is more than A. We already saw that. Okay, so we are moving from lower potential to higher potential. So when you move from lower potential to higher potential, right, you need to do some work. The external force has to do some work. There is some source is needed. If you take a battery, is the energy of the chemical reaction which will move from negative to positive, from a lower potential to higher potential. But if you want to move from higher potential to lower potential, you don't need to do any work. It will happen automatically. The charges will move. Okay, that is why we use this notation VAB as to move from B to A, to coincide with what we have seen in network theory. Now let's take a closed path. So what is a closed path? A closed path is one where my initial point and final point are the same. Okay, so VA, A and B are the same. So what happens? VA minus VB will be equal to 0. So closed path integral of E dot dl is equal to 0. Now we have something called as a gradient theorem, right? So given a scalar function t, then integral from B to A gradient, sorry, it is not t, it is v, a scalar function v, integral from B to A, the gradient of v dot dl is, I have mixed up here t and v, t a minus t b, right? And here, sorry for that. So here you see integral of E dot dl from A to B would simply, I have VA minus VB. So what would this become? This would become integral of gradient of V. Okay. So from which I get E is minus gradient of V. So the first equation, V is equal to minus integral E dot dl, will tell you how to find the potential if you know E. And the second one, E is equal to minus gradient of V, will tell you how to find the electric field if you know the potential. Now let's have a question. Supposing I give you an orbit field E. I say E is equal to something, some crazy function. And my question is, can you find a charge configuration which would give me this function E? Is it possible? So can E be any arbitrary function? Can I have it as an electric field, and can I have a charge configuration which will give me that field? Let us look at it. So what did I see? I saw integral, closed integral of E dot dl is equal to 0, right? And we have seen Stokes' theorem in our vector calculus class. So from Stokes' theorem, integral of E dot dl, closed line integral, is integral of curl of E dot dA. And what is dA? dA is the surface which this closed line encloses. We saw an open line does not enclose a surface. A closed line like a circle encloses a surface. Right. So from this, if this is 0, then this also has to be 0. Now dA is finite, so I can conclude that the curl of E is equal to 0. So such a field we have defined in vectors is called as a conservative field. That is, E is, the curl of E is equal to 0. So E, electric field intensity, is a conservative field. Clear? This is for static conditions. That means E is not a function of time for static conditions. So now you can answer my questions. If I give you an arbitrary field E, then if I ask you, can you give me any charge configuration which will give me that field E? First, take the curl of E. You know how to take the curl of V. We have done many problems on curls. If the curl is 0, then yes, you can have a charge configuration which will give you that field. E is a valid field. If the curl is not 0, E is not a valid field. What does that mean? That means that there is no charge configuration on Earth which can give you that kind of an electric field. That's the meaning. Right? So now back to some numericals. So given the potential, I hope you're clear about what is potential. Given the, it's a scalar, remember, given the potential field V equal to 2x squared y minus 5z and a point P minus 4, 3, 6. Why have I used field? Because it's a function of x, y, z. It's a field, but it's a scalar field. It doesn't have a direction. We'll find out many things about this. So first is, you find the potential at point P minus 4, 3, 6. Simple. Just substitute x is minus 4, y is 3 and z is 6 in this function. So 2, x is minus 4, minus 4 squared, y is 3, minus 5z, 5 into 6, that is 66 volts. So the potential at point P is 66 volts. Right? Next, I want you to find the field intensity E. So now I know V, how do I find E? So what is E? E is minus gradient of V, and you know what is the gradient, dou V by dou X, AX, plus dou V by dou Y, AY, plus dou V by dou Z, AZ. So let me differentiate this scalar function with respect to X. So what do I get here? I get this minus is because of this minus gradient. So I get 4xy ax and then dou v by dou y. So if I differentiate this with respect to y, I get 2x squared minus 2x squared ay. And then x with respect to z, I get minus 5 and the minus and minus will become plus 5 az volts per meter or joules per coulomb. So I have E. Now I can find E at this point P by substituting for X, Y and Z. So I get 48AX minus 32AY. I have simply substituted for X, Y, Z. Then the magnitude of E at point P is simply root of, you know, the components, 48 squared plus minus 32 squared, so on. And I want the direction of E. What is it? You know, it is the vector divided by the magnitude. So I have vector divided by the magnitude. So this is the unit vector in the direction of E at point P. And next I want to find D, right? So assuming free space, D is equal to epsilon naught E. So I just have to multiply E with epsilon naught. I have this. Next, I want the volume charge density. You remember yesterday in the last class, we saw the differential form of Gauss's law, right? What was the differential form of Gauss's law? The divergence of D is equal to rho V, the volume charge density. Now, what is the divergence of D? Remember the formula for divergence? It is dou dx by dou x plus dou dy by dou y plus dou dz by dou z. So it's a scalar. So I have to take the x term, ax term, that is minus 35.4xy, and differentiate with respect to x. I get minus 35.4y, right? Because I have to differentiate with respect to x. Then I have to take the y term, ay term, and differentiate with respect to y. But ay term is 17.71x squared, so differential with respect to y is 0. And az term is a constant, 44.3, so the differential with respect to z is 0. Therefore, the divergence of D is simply minus 35.4y picocoulomb per meter cubed, and this is equal to the volume charge density. So now at P, I know what is Y, so I substitute for Y and I get the volume charge density at point P. Right? So what did we do in this problem? If you know the potential function, then using that you can find the potential at any point, and taking the negative of its gradient, you get the electric field intensity, and you can find using that the electric field intensity at any point, right? And third, you can find out the flux density, which is epsilon naught into E, and you can also find the volume charge density, which is given by divergence of D. Clear? Now remember one thing, I don't know what is the charge configuration. I don't know whether it's, there are many point chargers or a combination of a surface point, I don't know. I just know that such a field can be created by having a volume charge of this density. Okay, so that's what is the implication of the problem we have discussed now. Now let's do one more thing with a line charge. I have a uniform surface charge density, 5 nanocoulombs per meter square. It's a surface. It is present at z equal to 0 plane. That means x and y are changing. And a uniform line charge density of 8 nanocoulombs per meter, located at x equal to 0, z equal to 4, and a point charge 2 microcoulomb at p 200. So what do I have here? I have three things. I have a point charge at 200, and I have a line charge at 0 y 4, and I have a surface charge at z equal to 0. That means x and y are varying from minus infinity to plus infinity. So now what I want you to find, if v is equal to 0 at a particular point m005, find v at n123. First understand the question. I have given you the reference point where the voltage is 0, potential is 0. The potential is at point 005 is 0. So I want you to find the potential at point n123 with respect to, obviously with respect to the reference. Remember I told you, when you talk of absolute potential, it is always with respect to the reference. So how do I do this? So remember, you, whenever you try to solve problems on potential, try to remember all the features of potential. First, we know it obeys superposition. Clear? So now let us find out what are the potentials due to each of these charges. So if I take a line charge, first get an expression, okay, and then substitute for the points. So if I take a line charge, my potential is q by 4 pi epsilon naught r. Right? So, if I take a point charge, and if I take a line charge, it is minus integral of the line charge density divided by 2 pi epsilon naught rho d rho plus some constant C1. So the integral works out to be minus rho L divided by 2 pi epsilon naught log of rho. Rho is the radial distance plus C1. C1 is to account for the constant. And what is my field due to a surface charge? We know it is rho s by 2 epsilon naught. Rho s is the surface charge density. The other notation is sigma. You can also use sigma. So if I differentiate integrate this with respect to z, I get minus rho s by 2 pi epsilon naught z plus C2. C2 is some constant. So now I have the expression due to a line charge, a point charge, due to a point charge, a line charge, and a surface charge. But all the C1, C2 and all, now I must have a common reference for all of them, right? So now the references are different, right? What do we mean by this? Look at this. What is this distance r? This r is the distance between the point and the point charge. Okay, now our point, whatever point where I want the potential. And this rho is the radial distance from the line charge and the point under consideration. And this is z. Z is the, again, the distance z. So what we will do is, so at m is equal to 005, I'll write a general equation for the potential. So this is due to point charge, this is due to line charge, and this is due to surface charge C. C is a constant which will take care of my whatever I want to choose. Okay, because my references for all of them are different. Now, where do I have a, now let me consider the point M. Why M? I am told that at M005 potential is 0. Right? See, unless you know the potential at some point, you cannot evaluate this constant C. Are you understanding? If I just have one point, I can't evaluate this constant C. I need to have some knowledge about the potential at any point, then I can find out what is this constant C. Now, I am told that the potential at 005 is 0. So now let's see what we can do. So let me take the point charge. Point charge is located at 200. So this point M, what is the distance between this point M and the point charge? Can you see? It is 2 minus 0 AX 0 0 0 minus 5 AY. Right? From this is my destination and this is my source. So it will be root of 2 square plus 5 square, that is equal to root 29. What is this root 29? Root 29 is the distance of point M from the point charge. Clear? Now, where is my line charge? My line charge is located at 0, y4. So remember, it is parallel to the y axis, so it will not have a y component. Okay, and so what is the radial distance between these two? 0 minus 0 is 0, don't take the y component, and 5 minus 4 is 1. Therefore, the radial distance rho is equal to 1. Okay, so now I know all I need to substitute here for point M. So what is the V? V is 0, that is given. And what is the distance from point charge? It is root 29. Okay. And the point charge is 2 microcoulombs. Then what is the radial distance rho from the line charge? It is 1. Okay. So I have log of 1, log of rho minus rho S is 5 nanocoulombs per meter squared by 2 epsilon naught. And what is Z? Z is 5. 5 plus C. Now, just a minute. I think I didn't highlight this. Why did I integrate this with respect to dz? So, look at the configuration of the surface charge. It is at z equal to 0. So, it is the xy plane. Are you clear? It's the xy plane. And what is the direction of the xy plane? It is normal direction, which is the z direction, and hence I have integrated it with respect to dz. So I do all this plus c I have, so now I can calculate c, right? So once I know c, I can find the potential at any point with respect to what? With respect to m. M is the reference. So now if I take n, right, the distance of n is 1, 2, 3, the distance from the point charge. Point charge is where? 2, 0, 0. So 2 and 1, so it will be root of 1, 0, so 4, and 3 is 9, so it is root 14. And the radial distance of n from the line charge is root 2, and z is equal to 3. I have already computed c, and so I just have to substitute everything and find out vn. So vn happens to be 1.98 kilovolts. Therefore, the potential of point n is 1.98 kilovolts with respect to potential at point m, which is 0. Okay, now let me do something a little bit tougher. So I have in spherical coordinates, E is equal to 2r divided by r squared plus a squared whole squared ar. So E is still in the radial direction, and here r is the point, the radial distance for any point where you want to find the field, and a is some constant. Find the potential at any point. We'll just see if we can use different references and do it. So first let me integrate. Let me find expression for v. V is what? Minus integral e dot dl. Since e is in radial direction, I have to take dr ar. So it will be 2r by r square plus a squared whole squared and dr. So when I do this integral, I get 1 by r squared plus a squared plus c. What is this? This is the expression for potential in general. Now, I want you to reduce this assuming v is equal to 0 at infinity. Okay, v is equal to 0 at infinity. So at infinity, v is 0. So R is infinity, so this whole term will tend to 0, therefore C is equal to 0. Clear? So if I choose infinity as my reference point, then due to this electric field, my potential at any point is simply 1 by R squared plus A squared. Clear? Now, supposing I choose V is equal to 0 at R equal to 0. Right? So what is it? Just see here. Now R is 0. That means my reference instead of infinity is at the origin. Radial distance is 0. So now what will happen? So V will be reduced to 1 by A squared plus C. So V, when R is 0, this will be 0. Therefore C is minus 1 by A squared. So what is the general expression? For V, I have already found out. 1 by R squared plus A squared. And C is minus 1 by A squared. And so I have a different expression. So what are we trying to see here? In this example, if you change the reference, then the potential of a point will also change. Now for the same problem, you just see, if you change the reference, the potential difference between two points will not change. They will remain the same. So the absolute potential changes. And I have my last problem here. So if we, it's same thing, continuation. If now it is neither at 0 nor at infinity, V is equal to 100 volts at R equal to 0. Right? So I have 1 at R equal to A. So what is my expression here? General expression here, R is equal to A, so this will become 1 by 2 A squared plus C, right? Yeah, so when R is equal to A, this becomes 1 by 2 A squared plus C, and this I told you that when R is equal to A, it is at 100 volts, so C becomes 100 minus 1 by 2 A squared, then I substitute for C and get the general expression for V. So you see, by suitably changing the reference, you know, you can do a bit of manipulation if you want simpler expressions for V. So I will close today's session with the highlights, two, three quick highlights. You do not need to expend any energy when you move along the field, whereas when you move against an electric field, you have to expend energy to move against the field. The potential difference between two points is defined as the work done in moving a unit positive charge from one point to the other, and V is equal to minus integral of E dot dl from initial to final point. And using gradient theorem, we got E is equal to minus gradient of V, and the potential has some key features. The potential difference does not depend on the reference. The absolute potential depends on the reference. You do not need to expend any energy to move along equipotential surfaces. You need to expend energy to move from lower potential to higher potential, and you don't need to expend any energy to move from higher potential to lower potential. So these are the key highlights. Thank you. I end today's session, and in the next class we will see the last part of this concepts, which is the energy density. Thank you.